There are forces acting on the satellite. One is the force of gravity, the other one is the centripetal force. If you equate these two at this orbit, the purpose here is the satellite should be turning with the same speed as the Earth. So it will be just like on our country, for example, on Europe or on America. So it is a fixed position, the speed is fixed, height is always. There are two different types of orbits there. One is the orbit around equator, so it is empty places that are filled with several countries' satellites. It is an important orbit. It is so-called geostationary orbit. There are also other types of satellites in order, usually for Earth observation, low orbit satellites. Then the altitude will be around 160 up to 1,000 kilometers. In between, we have some medium orbit satellites, usually the constellations for navigation satellites or some other satellites in this medium orbit. And another concept related with the satellites, it is sun synchronous orbit. When the satellite is turning around the Earth, we need energy. The energy will be supplied by solar panels. So solar panels should be always looking to the sun. So satellites will be turning around while the Earth is turning around the sun. So satellites will be turning around the Earth, always looking to the sun. It is so-called sun synchronous orbit. And we have another concept, important, we call transfer orbit. Because in order to go to geostationary orbit, I cannot send a satellite at a single step, just go to that orbit. First, it should go to an orbit around the Earth, and it should jump to another orbit and into another orbit. So there are two, three jumps there. So it is so-called transfer, geostationary transfer orbits. It is true for all other missions also. Another classification is due to size. We have large satellites, usually larger than 1,000 kilogram. Nowadays, Turkey is building Turkish 6A satellite. It will be four tons, so it is 4,000 kilograms. We have mini satellites between 500 and 1,000 kilogram. Micro satellites between 10 and 500 kilograms. We have nano satellites, usually done by some universities and research groups, and Pico satellites are so small, it is in the weight of a few kilograms. The other important part is the coverage. Now, usually for broadcast satellites, for example, we have some TürkSat satellites. On these satellites, we have different antennas, and we'll send the television signal to there, and this will be resent to the Earth on different places based on the structure of the antenna. For example, in the first antenna, here you can see, it covers Turkey. So what is the meaning of this dark coloring? You can use small antennas. If it is not so weak, for example, over here, you should use a larger antenna to cover the necessary signal coming from the satellite. The other antenna here, for example, covers Europe on the same satellite. It covers the mid-Europe, including Germany, France, Italy, etc. Also covers Turkey. So your antenna should be directed to this satellite, and to the, this antenna will be transmitting the necessary signal to you. There are two more antennas over there being developed. The antenna theory and precise antenna structures will be then possible, so we can cover in a single antenna more places with more power, so that you can use smaller antennas. I will share developments in Turkey with you on a timeline. In 1985, it is almost 40 years ago, research institute in the campus of Middle East Single University has been established, and it is a critical institute. I worked there from the beginning. It is in 1985. The importance of this space technologies and broadcasting was on days on those days were so important for us. And we built, but it is not homemade satellites. One is, all the others are built in France. The first Turkish satellite, Turksat 1A, when it is sent to the space, after a few, it is the satellite is exploded. So it was unsuccessful trial. The second satellite on the same year has been sent to space. It is Turkish 1B. We have usually 1A, 2A, ABC types satellites, depending on the positions on the geostationary orbit. After 2 years, we sent the third satellite, it is Turkish 1C, to the space. It is again built by French company Thales. And then I became the director of this institute, Electronics Institute, and I changed the name of the institute, and I extended the working areas of the institute, and I changed the name also. I changed the name coming from Bilgi Teknolojileri, and the working area of the institute has been extended. And in 1999, on days we were state planning department in Turkey, and I have written a report to the state planning department, and I explained in some steps how we can develop our space technology. First, we should construct a satellite in a foreign country, in a company premises with our engineers. The second step was to build our own satellite with the help of foreigners. And in the third step, we can do our, we can design and we can build our satellite. It was a three step, and then in the fourth step, in the sixth steps, I explained how we can go to space with our astronauts. And then I obtained a government grant, and I started discussing with the government, with the state planning department, how we can construct a satellite. It should be Earth observation, and on these days, you know, Turkey is in a very critical position. From when you consider our neighbors, we are in a very critical position, and we should observe our country. And this satellite had a mission. I put a mission to the satellite so that, do you know how we can understand, how we can visualize a three-dimensional structure? With our two eyes, we get images, and our brain combines these images and gives the depth information. And based on this, in the institute, we worked in a system so that with two different cameras, we can get two different images. And based on these two images, I can construct 3D images. So it is three-dimensional images can be constructed using two cameras. This philosophy I applied to this satellite. When the satellite goes over Turkey, it takes a picture. After a while, it turns around. It takes this picture of the same place. With these two different pictures, I could get three-dimensional figure of Turkey with 12-meter height and with 15-meter resolution. That was the mission of the I stated for the Biltansat. The project started with a company, with a university company in Surrey University in England. On these days, another Turksat has been sent to space, and our satellite has been sent to space on the year 2003. It had taken several pictures on different places. The importance of this one, I could take the picture of any place on the Earth. I have the images that can be stored on the satellite. When it comes over Turkey, these images will be downloaded. This way, we could get any images from the world. That was our purpose. It was operational for 3 years. And then it is understood that our institute is capable of doing satellite business. Then it is changed the name to TÜBİTAK Uzay, the Space Technologies Institute. Another Turkish, Turksat has been sent. It is on the year 2008. It is still operational. On these days, several attempts had been started in Turkey to send to small satellites to space. Istanbul Technic University sent a small satellite. Another Earth observation satellite built by our institute, Bilten or Uzay Institute, has been prepared and it is sent to space. And then another satellite with more precise, it is the resolution of the images will be 2.5 meter pixel or between two pixels, the difference will be 2.5 meters for black and white pictures, and it is 5 meter for colored pictures. And it was 400 kilogram. We could here get the three-dimensional structure of our country. And then TürkSat satellites that will built abroad, they started, they initiated projects internally. They started a project on small satellites, and they built TürkSat 3U satellite. And then for TürkSat 4 projects started, 4A has been sent to space, 4B sent to space, and the company now has moved from, the builder company moved from France to Japan. Mitsubishi has built these satellites. Another Earth observation satellite, so-called Göktürk 1, has been sent to satellite. Havelsan, together with, I think it's with Istanbul Technical University, they have built, with the aid of European Union, two satellites, and they have been sent to space. And in the year 2018, Turkish Space Agency has been built. Now, the importance of this Turkish Space Agency is that when you send a satellite to the space, someone or some organization should be owner of this satellite. For all the Turkish satellites, TürkSat satellites, you were not the owner. A company in France, and French Space Agency was the owner of the satellites. When we construct our, when we establish our space agency, then we will be owner of these satellites. So from now on, the year 2018, established our own space agency, and we are the owner of the satellites that has been sent afterwards. ASELSAN again started a new project, a small satellite. It is the beginning usually. And then Turkish 5A, 5B sent on the space on the year 2021. An interesting development is that Bülent Ecevit University has built a small, a very indeed, a Pico satellite. It is sent to Earth just to repeat some wireless signals, and it, with the help of Erdemir, still operational. Now we have another projects going on. One of them is another Earth observation satellite, but the distance between two pixels will be 1 meter. It, usually the purpose on the Earth is to build a satellite that takes images so that the distance between the pixels will be less than 1 meter. It is sub-meter satellites. It is under construction. We have another satellite. It is again for imaging. It is an important concept. It is SAR imaging. It is synthetic apar radar imaging. If we had such a satellite just at the beginning of this earthquake, we could determine whether it is cloudy or not. We could determine the damage that the earthquake has done to our country. We could count the, we could get the images below the clouds with the help of this technology. It is imaging. It is based on millimeter radar waves, and we could get such images. It is still, we are working on this. And I am also a monitor for the project for TürkSat 6A. There are several companies, this Uzay Institute involved, ASELSAN involved, TUSAŞ is involved, and another company, so-called JTEC, is involved on the communication of this satellite. It is to be built, and I think it will be end of the next year or the beginning of the 2025 that will send this satellite to the space. I am a member of the Space Research Group in TÜBİTAK, in the executive board there. We are planning nowadays on two different projects. I would like to share all these with you. One of them is sending a small satellite to Moon, because sending a satellite and finding the way how to go there is an important job. It is not so easy, because we should take we should put this satellite on the Earth orbit, and then it should widen the Earth orbit, and then it should jump to an orbit around Moon, and it will have a hard landing there. So it is an important project for Turkey to test the programs that we develop. Another project is to be sent an astronaut to International Space Station. And this astronaut will do there some experiments. Around 10 experiments will be done there. And it will, he will stay there for approximately 10 days and will return back to the Earth. Now, before completing, if you are interested in space technologies, there are some areas, not directly aeronautical engineering, but there are other disciplines that are related with space technology. One is, of course, electrical and electronics engineering. The other one is computer and software engineering, because there is a lot of computer programming there, real-time usually programming. Also, the mechanical engineers have an important job, because all the internal structures of the satellites, must be all heated. So the instruments there will be working at a normal temperature, at 20 degrees, 18 degrees. You can also be a physics engineer, or you will be involved in orbital discussions, or chemical engineering, or material engineer. These are all involved in space technologies. So just like aeronautical engineering, of course, they will contribute a lot, but not only, but it is an interdisciplinary field for study. Thank you for listening to me. Have a good day.
So, as you said, we're planning to send an, satellite to the Moon's orbit, but if you ask me, the USA, NASA, as I heard, that couldn't find anything on Moon, like, for example, living creatures and stuff, they're landing to the Mars, they're leading to the Mars, but I hope that you will make a way and find the creature or somehow something in Moon, but I don't have any hopes for that. But thanks anyways.
Yeah, you are right, but the purpose is always for scientific research is not to get a meaningful result. It is just the technology and process that we need to know. To comment on this, because it shouldn't be the purpose on Moon to find some living creatures, but there should be some minerals there. So Turkey should get her share from these sources. So it is a little bit complicated than we expect. We cannot predict 50 years ahead from now on.
Okay, I get it. Okay, I get it. Thank you.
I would like to thank a few people who have made all this possible. You realize by just the difficulty of putting all of these students in one room at the same time, which we have failed to do, obviously, that this is not easy a thing to do. So first of all, again, I would like to thank the rector for supporting this event today in any way possible. And believe me, he did a lot to make it all happen. I would like to thank our dean, Professor Yashar Shahin, the Faculty of Engineering, who has more patience with me than any human I have ever known. And thank you for that, sir. I really appreciate your patience. It's a difficult thing to put together all the pieces here in this case. I would like to thank my department chair, Professor Dr. Dia Gadelmavla, for actually kicking off the idea of having a workshop last year when we hosted our same guest last year and 9 others from NASA and NASA subcontractors on the subject of free open source software. So thanks to the Professor Dia that workshop was initiated. Now, Elif Hanım, are you here? Is Elif here or not? No. Okay. Elif was the administrative assistant to the Faculty of Engineering, and she moved mountains for this meeting to happen. And on weekends, late at night, it was amazing. I think that Elif deserves an applause. If you would please join me. Thank you. And I would also like to thank the Vice Dean, Görkem Üçtü, my dear friend, who speaks amazing English, amazing Turkish, understands all cultures, and he's always the problem solver. When Görkem is away from my office, from the office, I am pretty much lost. And really, I would like to thank him for all the effort that he makes in the last 6 years, actually, to create a bridge between East and West, which is not as simple a thing as just learning languages. It's complicated. So thank you, Görkem. And finally, Ms. Dileydi Kazan, the head of the Tanatim division, who put together the public part of all this meeting. And I thank very much also Dileydi Hanım for this. All right. So with this in mind, hopefully I haven't forgotten anyone, but I know that there are other people that made this possible. And thank to all those who were not named directly. I would like now to welcome our guest from off campus, my fellow Californian friend, Professor Jay Trimble from NASA Ames. He's the mission system manager for the Viper lunar rover mission at NASA Ames Research Center in Silicon Valley, California. Prior to this, Jay founded and led the user-centered technology group, which developed open mission control technologies, open MCT, the Merboard touchscreen for Mars rover operations and planetary data system user technologies. At UC Berkeley, Jay was the integration and test manager for the high energy solar spectroscopic imager. At the Jet Propulsion Laboratory, Jay was lead operations director for Space Radar Lab, which flew two successful missions on the space shuttle Endeavour. He was a member of the science operations support team for the Voyager spacecraft encounter with Neptune. At Jones Space Center, Jay was the space shuttle mission controller in the payloads discipline. Jay has a bachelor's degree in geology from UC Berkeley and a master's degree in computer science from USC. There are few people that are as thoroughly Californian, I think, other than, what do I see here? Houston, that would be the only time that you went astray from California. Is that correct? Yeah, more or less, yeah. So, and actually, Jay left JPL a few months before I got there, but we knew a lot of the same people. So, NASA is going back to the moon. It's such an exciting presentation for me to see here at our university. At the same time, the Turkey is planning to do a mission also to the moon. So there is nothing more timely than I can imagine than having him here. And I really would like to thank him for actually having suggested being present, coming back from a conference in Dubai on aerospace also, and on the way back to the United States. And it's a delight to have you. Jay, please come to the front.
But I may not stick with it. So I'm going to start with a personal thought or two before I start my talk. One, I just wanted to say how happy and excited I am to be here, and thank you for hosting me and for that warm welcome. And I also just wanted to take a moment to recognize and give my sympathies to all of the victims of the recent earthquake. It's something we've been very much aware of in the United States, and I extend my sadness to all of you who've been affected by that. Okay, with that, I'm going to talk about how we are headed back to the moon. I'm also going to take a look back at how we did this half a century ago with the Apollo missions, and where we're headed. Okay, so Fabrizio, he talked a little bit about my bio. I grew up in an era when the United States was striving to put a man on the moon, and I was a young kid when that happened. And for you all, that's part of the history books, but my childhood here was model rockets and looking forward to that first ever human footprints on the moon. And then in college, I got an internship at Johnson Space Center in Houston. So you can imagine for a kid, forget about the microphone. You can imagine for a kid, can you all hear me?
to all of a sudden be in mission control was a remarkable thing. And at that point, we were flying the space shuttle. So after college, I took a job at Mission Control in Houston, and that was amazing. Then, as Fabrizio said, the Jet Propulsion Laboratory, where we flew by Neptune. Okay, got better? Okay. And then I got my first really cool leadership position at the Jet Propulsion Lab, where we flew an Earth observing radar on the Space Shuttle Endeavour twice. And now I'm working on a lunar rover, I think is my pointer. And frequently people ask me, how big is it? So to answer that question, I just go and stand next to a mock-up of the rover so that I can answer that question, because for some reason people are really curious about the size. Okay, let's talk about the moon. It was a little bit more than half a century ago when Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin set foot on the moon. Is this familiar to people? Like if I ask people about the moon landing, is this something that everybody has learned in school, you've heard about? I'm just looking for nodding heads or raising hands. Okay, July 1969, it was actually July 20th, 1969. And this is what the view looked like on the TV screens. It was a very blurry view. And anybody who was alive and old enough at that time remembers, we all remember where we were. I was with my family watching on this very small black and white television set that would be unimaginable to you all now. And I bet the folks who are my age, I bet you all remember where you were when we took those first steps on the moon. And then later, of course, we got these great high-quality imagery. But when we were watching at the time, it looked about like that. So what have we done since then? Because nobody's walking on the moon right now, are they? That's about to change. Since then, the emphasis has been on robotic exploration. We flew the space shuttle. We built the International Space Station, right? We've done amazing things. But in terms of leaving Earth orbit and exploring, it's been robotics. This is Jupiter. This is Jupiter's moon Io. You see that right there? That is a volcano on Io. Nobody expected this, right? Nobody expected to go out and find volcanoes on a world around Jupiter. Nobody expected, that I'm aware of, maybe Arthur C. Clarke, but most of us did not expect to find oceans like we believe exist on Europa. It's simply remarkable. Enceladus, a moon of Saturn with geysers that actually may contain elements of life. Robots on Mars, which one of you mentioned earlier. So we are finding remarkable things with robots. And then looking outward to the universe, this is the Hubble Space Telescope. It's not James Webb, because nobody has a great picture of James Webb. It is too far away. But Hubble is close enough that the space shuttle could take pictures of it. And we have peered deep into the universe. But my point is that since 1972, okay, think about that. That's history for most of you out there. Since 1972, no human being has even left Earth orbit, let alone set a foot on another world. Okay, I'm very happy to say that this is about to change. It's been a long wait. Okay, I was 8 years old when we landed on the moon. If you told me then that by now, by 2023, that nobody would have been back, I'd have said, no, I don't believe you. But that's where we are. And we are at a renaissance in space exploration. We are about to do great and amazing things. And this will happen in your lifetime. In fact, your immediate lifetime. Okay, I'm going to take a brief look back, and I'm going to talk about what we did half a century ago and how we did it with Apollo. I'm assuming most of you folks have seen this, okay? The Saturn V rocket, the largest rocket at the time, the largest rocket until just recently when we flew the Space Launch System. Okay, so what I want to emphasize, of all this rocket, the people were here in what was called the command module. And I'll show close-up pictures of that. And this is the only piece that came back to Earth. And this rocket and its power enabled humans to leave Earth orbit and go to the moon. Okay, so the vehicles we used, the spaceships that we used. This is called the command module. That's where the people are. And I want to think, you know, so people are in this for 10 days. It is a small and cramped space. Imagine being in this small and cramped space for that long. I think it takes a very special person to be able to do that. And the astronauts of that era were a very special breed. Okay, this is the service module. Rocket propulsion, rocket thrusters, power, communications, but only this part came back to Earth. Okay? This was their transportation from Earth orbit to the moon and back. This, the lunar module, let's go to the next slide, was their transit to the surface. So I'm going to show a diagram of this. It's a little bit complicated, and I'll apologize in advance for that. But the astronauts went to the surface in what was called the lunar module. Okay, we think of this as the only pure spacecraft ever built. And I say that because it only flew in space. The space shuttle flew in the atmosphere. It also flew in space, right? This vehicle only flew on the moon. The descent stage that guided them down and the ascent stage where they went back and rendezvoused with their colleagues who were waiting in lunar orbit. And then this vehicle, anybody seen this? It's called the Lunar Rover. It's basically a car for driving on the moon. Kind of fun, the idea of driving on the moon, right? Okay. All right, I know this is complicated, okay? Bear with me. I will take you through it. So you start with that Saturn V launch, and you start right here, okay? And you go into orbit, and you lose the first stage and the second stage. You take the third stage with you. And on top of that third stage is the lunar module, which I just showed you, and the command and service module with the astronauts on it, okay? You go into a circular orbit around the Earth, and you check out the spacecraft systems, and mission control then gives you a go to do the burn that will take you to the moon, okay? It's called TLI, translunar injection. We just lost one? Okay. All right, so you do that TLI burn, that translunar injection burn. You leave Earth orbit. Okay. What, am I stepping on something or causing that? Okay. All right, at that point, on the way to the moon, this vehicle turns around, okay? That command module goes and picks up and rendezvous with the lunar module, okay? Now, we don't have any pictures of that, but if I can go back, this is the lunar module docked to the command module. That's the best thing I have with a picture of that, right? Because there was nothing from a distance that could take a whole picture. That stack goes to the moon, okay? Goes into a low lunar orbit. Two astronauts now, there's three astronauts, okay? Two of them get into that lunar module, go to the surface of the moon. They explore, they come back, they rendezvous with their colleague in that command service module. They go back to Earth and land. I hope that made sense. I know it's a complicated diagram. If anybody has questions, I will stay around after and be happy to answer questions. Okay, so this was it. From 1969 to 1972, we did these amazing things. I used to go outside when I was a little kid, when there were people on the moon, and I would stare up at the moon and just think, my God, there are people on that. And I really look forward to not only having that experience again, but you all having that experience, because it is a remarkable thing. And I think when you grow up watching something that inspirational, you kind of believe you can do anything. So think about all the people who've ever been on Earth, billions, 12 of them have set foot on another world, which is the moon, okay? There was no internet, let alone a mobile phone. We watched on simple, mostly black and white TVs. If you were really lucky, if you were, you know, one of those few, you had a color TV. But that was pretty rare back in those days. Let alone an internet or a mobile phone. What did we accomplish? At the time, people said, why do we go to the moon? People still ask this question. People will continue to ask that question. Why did we go? So this is the first Earthrise. You've all seen a moonrise, right? The first Earthrise seen by human eyes, it's a very famous picture. It was taken by the crew of Apollo 8 in 1968. Those three men were the first to ever leave the cradle of Earth orbit and head out towards the moon. And they found something remarkable in this picture. One of those astronauts, Bill Anders, when he got back to Earth, said, "We went there to find the moon, but instead we found the Earth." And that's just a matter of the remarkable perspective of being so far from home and turning back and looking back at our own world. What else did we accomplish? I think there tends to be an emphasis on economic accomplishment, right? We built new economies. We built new industries. We paved new pathways in computer science. We did amazing things here on Earth and created new technologies, right, that we all benefit from. And we did that in getting to the moon. But I think as important, and this is just my personal opinion, is the knowledge and perspective we got of seeing our world from a distance, of asking ourselves what is our place in the cosmos, of seeing the Earth and seeing those amazing views. You all grew up with that. It's commonplace now, but it was not commonplace at the time. And I think we live with the benefits of that perspective. Recently in California, I was talking to a young person just out of college about the James Webb Space Telescope. And he was talking about the inspiration that he got from that and how that carried over into his own life. Because when you see something so amazing, you believe you can do anything. And growing up, watching people land on the moon, there was this belief that we could do anything. And I think that carries over into what we do on Earth. For in the United States, we had 400,000 people working on Apollo, okay? That was 2% of the American workforce at the time. This was a massive undertaking. And it was a peacetime undertaking. It was purely for peaceful purposes. Okay. Michael Collins, one of the Apollo 11 astronauts. We all know Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin because they went to the surface. But Mike Collins faithfully waited in orbit for them to go down and come back. Okay? All of the Apollo astronauts toured the entire world after they landed. And Mike Collins, wrote, and here's one of his comments, about the sense of unity. And it wasn't just a sense that Americans did it. It was a sense that all of humanity had accomplished something remarkable. Mike Collins wrote a book called Carrying the Fire. It's an amazing book about his journey to the moon and being an astronaut. Okay, actually, you know what? Let me talk about this for a moment. So who's familiar with Artemis? Just one person? When I say Artemis and space, wow, okay. All right, well, let me try and change that perspective a little bit. So Artemis, in mythology, is the twin sister of Apollo. And our program to go back to the moon, right? It was only men back then, but now it's going to be a much more inclusive program. It's going to be sustainable. We are going to keep going back, and it will be men and women. It will be international. It will be people from everywhere who will have a chance to go to the moon this time. And that program is called Artemis, named by our last administrator. Okay, so there's a lot in this slide other than space vehicles, and I'm going to talk to that. So, again, does anybody know, recently we flew the Space Launch System, a big Saturn V-class rocket. Was anybody familiar with that? Space Launch System, Orion, is that familiar to anybody? Okay, a few. All right, good. With a new capsule, looks like that command module that I showed you, but it's bigger, it's more capable. And this service module, remember we had a command module and a service module. Orion is built in the United States. The service module is European. The gateway that I'll talk about in a minute is going to be built by many nations, as is the International Space Station, right? The International Space Station flies astronauts from everywhere, including your country, coming up shortly. Also here, it's a very different relationship with government and industry, okay? So Artemis 1, we've already flown, right? That was the Space Launch System recently. No human beings on board. Artemis 2, Artemis II is coming up within the next 2 years, I believe. That is going to fly people around the moon, but in a more distant orbit than previously done. So for the first time since 1972, human beings will leave low Earth orbit. And I can tell you, for some of us, it's been a very long wait, okay? More than 50 years. There's going to be a lunar gateway. That's essentially an outpost in lunar orbit for doing science, but also for logistics and creating that sustainable presence I talked about. And then there's going to be a human landing system. The human landing system is going to be built by industry. So this is a NASA space capsule, a European service module. And we're going to have an American commercial SpaceX for the first mission to transport astronauts to the surface and back. That's really significant. That really opens up a lot of innovation and a lot of opportunity for everyone your age who's interested in working in space, right? When I went out into the world, you could either get a government job, you know, and I went to NASA, or a government contractor. The opportunity now is unlike anything I've ever seen before. I'll highlight the Viper Lunar Rover because that's the project that I'm working on. And we are going to land at the South Pole, okay? So people say we've been to the moon. Okay, we have been to 6 spots on the moon, but there is a lot more to explore. There's a lot more to learn. Somebody asked a question about that. At the poles, we believe there is water, and Viper is going to be a scouting mission to map the water resources at the poles and give us a better understanding of what future crews might find there. Also, all these little vehicles here, those are commercial landers, okay? And I say it again, that is super important. Instead of NASA saying, building our own lander or going to industry and giving a contract with a design, we are buying a service, okay? And that service is very different from buying a vehicle, and it's a really important concept to understand. We are saying to industry, deliver us to the moon. We're not telling them how, okay? If you wanted to go someplace and you said, buy me a car, that's very different from saying, I want to get someplace. Maybe you'd take a bicycle, maybe you would take a train, maybe you'd take a taxi. But by specifying it this way, we give industry room to innovate. So I'm also excited about that. Okay, so a little more about this. As I mentioned, we're buying a service. Failure is not an option. Has anybody ever heard that saying, failure is not an option? It was made famous by a NASA flight director named Gene Kranz, if you're familiar with the Apollo 13 mission, right, where we had, it was a very heroic effort, I think, to bring those astronauts back. And Gene Kranz wrote a book called Failure is Not an Option, okay? The ability to fail when you are designing and building something is actually an important part of the process. If you can't fail, you can never try anything. But once you have human beings in space, failure is no longer an option. And I say that in the context of these lunar landers because there is a tolerance for a new technology to fail at some point when there are no people on board. Okay, here's a picture of a computer graphics render, something you're all familiar with, of our Viper rover going off of our commercial lander built by a company called Astrobotic. So let's think a little bit about why we're going back to the moon and how our understanding of the moon has changed. I believe somebody in the back of the room asked a question about, you know, what we will find on the moon. Don't we understand the moon pretty well? Well, it turns out that recent missions to the moon have changed our understanding of the moon, including we expect now to find water in the form of ice, not in the form of liquid, at the poles. Why is that significant? Because it gives resources for a lunar base, right? It also creates the potential for fueling rockets. And if you are going to explore space, it is not practical to take everything from Earth. If you go on a vacation, if you go on a backpack trip, you know, you can't take everything with you. You have to live off the land. You have to get stuff at your destination. Okay. Here's our little lunar rover. Again, computer generated. low sun angle, very dark at the lunar poles, very different from what the Apollo astronauts encountered. Shadows, very black because there's no atmosphere. So I'm going to let this run. Navigation cameras, drill to drill down into the surface. Science instruments to do that prospecting for water. It's a very slow rover. I have to let it finish. And again, I'll point out how low that sun is over the horizon. And when you've got a rover that's powered by the sun, that's an issue. Okay, so as I said, we've found substantial evidence from orbit of water at the poles. We want to go look for that on the ground. In situ resource utilization, ISRU, we use a lot of fancy terms at NASA, but it really just means living off the land. And so when one of these missions, and it was an impactor, it was called LCROSS, and it was looking for water on the moon, and I remember when evidence for water on the moon was found. Okay, that was recently within the last 12 years or so, and I just want you all to remember this moment when some dramatic new discovery, something we couldn't even imagine, is found in space, because it will happen in your lifetime. I can't tell you what it will be, but we will find things that we could barely imagine. Okay, this is Viper, another complicated diagram. So let's think about what this means. So mission control, when I say that, have people seen pictures of mission control? Apollo, rooms filled with computers where we operate spacecraft on Earth. Is this familiar to anyone? Not a few heads. I see some heads nodding. A few of you. Okay. Mission control is in Silicon Valley, Houston, and Florida. And that is enabled by that fancy internet technology so that we can now control missions from multiple places instead of all having to be in one place. Computer software is something you're all familiar with. This software, Open Mission Control Technology, is what we will use in Mission Control to visualize data. I'm highlighting that because it is open source. Any one of you could go get that software off the internet, download it, and use it yourself. We have users, because of open source, all over the world for this software, including hobbyists. So yes, it's used by space agencies, it's used by commercial space companies, but it's also used by Internet of Things, for example, just for folks doing their hobbies. We've had people in other countries, somebody from Africa was talking to us about using it for monitoring irrigation, for example. A broad spectrum of uses, and the fact that it's open source, you can use it, and you could even write code for it if you wanted to and use it for your own purposes. That's very new. That's a new concept. All right, so let's see where we are here. So for Viper, we get off the lander. We have the concept of science stations, which is as it sounds. We are in a science station. We are looking for those water resources and trying to understand where they are, what the horizontal distribution is, and how deep it is. We have a drill where we can go up to a meter, I believe, okay? We have a science team working with us in mission control to direct that, and other than that, we're on rails like a train, just going places. Can anybody tell me what light speed is, how fast light travels?
300,000.
You know, that's interesting. I don't know it in kilometers per second. I only know it in, it's 186,000 miles. So I'm going to take your word for it that that's right. But, you know, that is mind-bogglingly fast, okay? So round trip to the moon, if you send a signal from the time you send it, I'm going to wait for you guys to, okay, from the time you send it till the time you see what happened, it's going to be about 6 to 10 seconds. Now, the light speed part of that is only about 2.5 seconds. The communication system adds some overhead. So imagine if you were flying a drone or maybe doing a radio-controlled airplane or a radio-controlled car. If you were going to control it and wait 6 to 10 seconds to find out what happened, that's a long time. You can't really joystick it. If you were at Mars, you'd be waiting 10 to 20 minutes. Imagine sending something and wait, I'm sorry, 10 to 20 minutes, that's one way. You could be waiting up to 40 minutes round trip. Imagine sending a command to your radio-controlled car or your drone and not knowing what happened for 40 minutes. So you have to operate very differently depending on where you are, how deep you are in space. So for us, we can't do a joystick. We can't do direct teleoperating. We can command, we go to a waypoint, we stop, we get our data, we look at the images, we go another 5 meters. There we go. Now I'm using your units. And we do speak in meters when we're talking our mission. Okay. I don't know if these rovers are familiar to folks. These are the Mars rovers, and they have been somewhat famous. 1996, Sojourner. 2004, two Mars exploration rovers. These are solar-powered rovers. And now, Mars Science Laboratory, and then Perseverance in 2020. Maybe some of you remember these rovers, remember the landings, are aware these two rovers are still operating on Mars. You can go to the web. You can see the latest pictures from Mars. And we are looking for environments that may have fostered life because we are still trying to understand and looking for life. Oops. Oops. Okay. Thank you. Looking for life out there. Noteworthy, there has been no American robotic rover to the moon yet. That's going to change soon. We had an American rover, a NASA rover, that was driven by astronauts, but no rover that was purely robotic. Russia, in the 1970s, sent its Lunokhod rovers to the moon, explored, brought back samples. China, with its U-2 rovers. And there are a number of commercial rovers, that I believe, that will get to the moon before our Viper rover gets there. Okay, so the Space Launch System, maybe folks saw this, was recent. If it looks at all familiar, it's got solid rocket boosters from the space shuttle, main engines from the space shuttle. This was the uncrewed mission I told you about. And here we are with our fancy new space capsule. Let's go to this one. So here's a view that human eyes have not seen. On the next mission, human beings will see the Earth-Moon system for the first time. I can't wait. And again, no human eyes have ever seen that before. Only robots. This is coming up on Artemis 2. All right, the human landing system, I mentioned that for the first mission. This is being done by SpaceX. How many people have heard of SpaceX? Heads nodding? Okay, all right, a lot of people. Excellent. So, and then again, that's part of that commercial space capability that I've been talking about. Okay, does this look like a nuisance that I should run through really quickly? I'll run through this quickly. Okay. Into orbit, command and service module, distant orbit around the moon, come back. Okay, that was quick. Oh, God, I'm trying to explain how we're going to go back, and I know this one even I had to look at this and think about this. It's significantly more complicated than the way we did it last time, but it is intended to be more sustainable and more flexible over time. So I'm just going to touch on this. And again, if somebody has a question when I'm done, feel free to ask. But as before, we launch from Earth, we leave Earth orbit in that command module with the service module. We are not at this point rendezvousing with a lunar module as we did for Apollo. Okay, I'll wrap it pretty quickly and let everybody give a chance to ask questions. I'm almost done. And I know this is a lot to absorb, but I'll just give an overview. We'll see how far we get here. So we get to the moon and we go into, I'm not going to explain it, but it's called a near rectilinear halo orbit, okay? And in that orbit, some of you, this is making sense. What's that? Excellent, okay. In that orbit, the human landing system, built by SpaceX for the first mission, will come and pick up the astronauts, take them to the surface where they will explore, they'll come back, and then they'll go back to Earth. Okay, I'm simplifying something that's extremely complicated. Okay, that's it. I wanted to show you some of my favorite space resources. There's a million things out there on the World Wide Web that you can find. Some great documentaries and a place to find pictures, and that's it. I can take questions if anybody has them.
Thank you very much. Any questions that you would like to ask?
Well, thank you for the conference.
Of course.
You said rovers have been sent to Moon and Mars throughout the years, but what of the moons of Mars, Phobos and Deimos? Is it worth to send rovers there to explore those tiny little rocks compared to Mars?
So scientifically, I think there is interest in sending robots to Phobos and Deimos. I'm not aware of any NASA plans to do that right now. I've heard talk, but there's nothing that I'm aware of that's in work at the moment.
Okay,
But I believe scientifically it would be interesting.
Okay, thank you.
Sure.
Good question.
Good question, absolutely. I'm going to let you all call on people and I'll just answer them. Yeah.
I don't know why, but I see 50% boys and girls, but only the boys are raising their hands. Is this a problem? I would have to take one on one. Is this okay? Any lady with a question?
And I can stay and answer as many questions as you want. I'm going to stay and talk to whoever wants to talk.
So you're not running away, right?
No.
Okay, good.
You talked about how it was a remarkable experience to, you know, saw Apollo, but why there hasn't been sent any humans since then? It has been almost 50 years and no one was sent. Why is that?
Well, I'll tell you, I've asked myself that question a lot of times. It's not because we didn't know how. You know, I think it's a matter of desire and the will to do so. And for some reason, so after Apollo, right, Apollo was very expensive. There was a sense that we wanted to lower the cost of spaceflight. And the sense was that the space shuttle, which was a reusable vehicle, would form the basis of a lower cost way of exploring space, and then we would build space stations, and then we would go back to the moon. Of course, these things turned out to be a lot more complex than we thought, right? And the space shuttle was also expensive to operate. I think you're going to find with industry, and particularly what SpaceX is doing, that we are getting economies of scale that will actually significantly lower the cost of spaceflight. You know, that's a complex question. And I think it's a matter of basically the will to do so. But somehow we have found the will again to do amazing things. And you all will benefit from that in your lifetime. I'm glad I still get here to get to see it.
Witnessing it will be amazing, I think, too. Thank you so much.
Thank you for the conference, first of all. I think it was very informative. My question is, when you send these like modules to space, and wait a minute, the metals, they stay there, right? Rocket modules.
The rocket modules stay together. Is that the question?
No. My question is, when they leave the module, they stay in the space, right?
Yes.
Yes.
If I understand your question.
Yes, and isn't that some kind of a debris, like in the space? Isn't that some kind of a contamination?
So there is debris in space, and so there's a number of different types of debris. And again, I'm not an expert on this, right? From a spacecraft operations perspective, there is the potential for damage from space debris. I believe James Webb, the space telescope, which is distant from Earth, was impacted by one micrometeorite which damaged a mirror. In low Earth orbit, there are a number of objects, right, that are human-made that we can track. You know, there is shelter on the space station if there is a danger of an impact. That's about really all I know about space debris. I'm not an expert in that, but there certainly is stuff out there.
Yeah, thinking about all the satellites and all the little robots, I think there's not an end to this. Like, if they just pile up, it's kind of a problem, I think.
I think certainly we're getting to the point now where that needs to be managed. You know, we didn't have the capability to launch enough vehicles into space to make that an issue until very recently. But when you're looking at these constellations of over 1,000 satellites and things, I think you're absolutely right. That is something we are going to have
maybe
to manage.
Maybe NASA like plan something to clear up the space.
Yeah, you know, so that would be not just NASA. I think that would be broader policy, both within the United States and mm-hmm. international policy for how to manage that. And again, that's not my area of expertise, but I think it's an important issue you're bringing up.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. My question is a more personal one.
Sure.
Do you think that the United States would develop this much on space if it didn't go through the Cold War era?
You know, that's really one for the history books more than it is one for me. You know, that's been extensively written about. What is the motivation? What was the motivation? I listened to a great podcast on that topic. I wish I could remember. It was about the Washington Post. I mean, it literally traced, you know, the origins of science fiction and kind of planting the seeds of going into space, how the technology came together, and how the politics came together. You know, and that really is a question for the history books more than it is one for me. But it's a great question and very interesting. And I would encourage you to read about it if you're interested in that.
Okay, thank you.
Sure.
Before we continue, I would like to say on behalf of the faculty here that the English of these students is amazing. I mean,
yes, truly amazing.
Really well. I mean, wow, I couldn't have spoken like that when I was in Italy as a student. So congratulations. You're being taught very well about the English language. That's wonderful. And that's a great asset for you. Next question.
Thank you. First of all, thank you for spending your time with us. My question may be a bit specific, but I have a question about electronics and their operations in space, because in Earth we have a magnetic shield which shields us from all the cosmic rays and sun's harmful rays, and we don't consider it while designing things, but in space we don't have that. As far as I know, Moon doesn't have a magnetic field. So what measures do we take to avoid any problems caused by cosmic rays or sun's things? Because if a particle comes and flips one bit in that rover's memory chip, then maybe the rover's program will no longer work and it will be
sure.
useless. Like, what's
so a couple of things, you know, again, and I'm coming from the perspective of how we operate spacecraft, right? There is the idea of radiation hardening and qualification for spaceflight. So there are a set of components that are certified to fly in that environment and that are hardened to protect from exactly what you're talking about. I think of it as rad hard radiation hardening, you know, and I'm sure the experts in that field could say more. And then there's the idea of a single event upset, an SEU, right, where a cosmic ray or something has gone in and caused an issue, and that can cause problems. I believe there are commercial companies that are interested in flying off-the-shelf commercial hardware with extensive redundancy and say, okay, instead of spending the money that it takes to certify and make rad hard these components, we'll fly more of them, except the fact that we are going to get some single event upsets and be tolerant of that. Okay, and again, that's not something that I spend a lot of time thinking about, because NASA components are rad hard, but I think it's an interesting area, given the cost and complexity of doing that, for going forward, how you could take different approaches and say, okay, maybe we're just going to be a little bit more failure tolerant. I think there's also an issue with how long those components last. We did fly something called the Long Duration Exposure Facility on the space shuttle. You could look at for that with your favorite search engine, but again, from the operator's perspective, yes, it's an issue. We do have single event upsets. We do have strategies to protect against that, both operationally and in how we design the components. And it is a question going forward of how we can fly commercial components and be more tolerant to those failures.
Okay, thank you.
Sure.
I would like to have one last question from that area over there. Yeah, okay. Yeah, stand up. This area on the right is not spoken at all.
Okay. I can I'm not in a hurry if you.
I'm under orders.
Okay. Under orders. All right.
Yeah, I'm being managed.
Okay.
Thank you for your presentation. And I was gonna ask if we have any way to make fuel for ourselves by using only space ingredients that we can find and maybe recreate that shuttles in moon.
So the word for that is in situ resource utilization, if you want the official word. ISRU, you could search on that, ISRU space, in situ, IN, and then situ is SITU, resource utilization. That's the idea, and you are absolutely headed in the right direction. The idea is living off the land. You cannot keep taking all these things from Earth. There's a number of ways to approach that. I believe the initial concepts are some things from Earth and some things that you would make in space. And this is why we're looking for water on the moon, right? And this is why we have, I believe, an ISRU experiment on Mars right now trying to extract oxygen from the atmosphere, because once you can do that, you can make rocket fuel and you have water. But again, how far you would have to go to live completely off the land, I don't know. I'm sure that has been studied and written about.
All right. Thank you very much.
Can I ask another question?
I am at 11:30. I'm just a second. I need to ask the flight controller. Can I go past 11:30? Okay. Go ahead.
Okay. I was going to ask if there is a way to transfer information faster than light, maybe by using quantum computers and, like, I don't know the word of it, but so maybe you understand what I said.
I think, you know, how to beat Einstein, I don't personally know how to beat Einstein. It certainly is talked about, it's written about, right? That's warp drive from Star Trek. You know, I'm not well versed in. I mean, I would love to say that the answer to that is yes. I don't know. I'm not aware of any way to do that.
I understand. Thank you.
All right. I think that this is did you do well? What do you think? Was it a good job?
Good.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, it was, yes, please.
Thank you for all your coming over here. I have two answers for your questions. One of them is, yes, there is a magnetic belt around the Earth. It is so-called, if I am not wrong, Van der Belt. When I was planning the Viltansat, they said around the Pacific Ocean there is a belt and you shouldn't be in this orbit. Have you heard of the novel Bermuda Şeytan Üçgeni? Yeah, couldn't understand the importance of this magnetic belt, and several planes, because of the damage in the electronic instruments, have fallen in this. There is a belt in the over the Earth. The second question was about the garbage over the space. Now there are 8,000 space vehicles around the Earth now. Only half of them are active. The others are garbage, and you are very right. And it is now understood that we should take off these garbage vehicles. And for example, on the design of Turkisat that we are doing now in Turkey, we will adjust the orbit, we should use there some kind of gas, because there is a slight air there and the speed is decreasing and it is falling down. The gas falls, it keeps you up in the orbit. But at the end of its life, there will be some gas that will put this vehicle to the far space. So it will not be turning around Earth. So it is now understood by human being that there is a garbage over the space. Thank you.
Well, splendid. It was. Thank you, Rector, for the for those clarifications. I appreciate that. So I would like to thank everybody for your visit, and I would like to say just a few words about our department at the Izmir University of Economics. Our speaker, who will return tomorrow for more technical conversations, has described one piece of software, OpenMCT, that is free open source, and we haven't had the time to go into it today, but we will do that better tomorrow. If you listen carefully, which you are not doing right now, right, yeah? So if you listen carefully, he said that you can go to the computer and download it. So I would like to challenge you young people to find this thing called OpenMCT and put it into your computers. Surprise us, because it's free. And there is so much software out there, tens of millions of lines of code, including GMAT that we use here, and other pieces of code that NASA uses and has designed, actually, that you can put into your computers. So sometimes people pay for, games or whatever it is, but you know, GMAT or one of these software like OpenMCT, the best game you will ever get for free. So keep in mind that a lot of these questions you can answer by yourselves if you go and install free open source software that is available online. Thank you again for visiting here. We will stop it today, and I wish you a great rest of the semester. Good luck.